I love coffee, I love tea, I love the Java Jive and it loves me.
So coffee. I think that's a great thing. The the homes on the other end of the scale, the really big ones that are, you know, the extreme opposite of affordable, sometimes called mega mansions or
McMansions.
Those, you know, the concern is just that they could potentially be wasting a ton of energy. Mm-hmm. You have houses now that sometimes have three or four large central air conditioning units, which is like sort of hard to understand because you think central air covers the whole house.
Yes.
But the house is so big, they actually have multiple central air units.
Mm-hmm.
And those kinds of things, they could be much more efficient. So the duct system is energy efficient in the Energy Star homes, and we can sort of tighten all that up and reduce mm-hmm. how much energy is being wasted. And that does affect the rest of the community
mm-hmm.
because if there's a lot of people that are large users who are wasting, well, they're putting a demand on fuel, and by them putting a demand on fuel, that's pushing the price up.
Sure.
So it's good for all of us if we can get some of the big users to reduce.
Right.
You know, so that's the direction we're heading. And there is an economic development part to the, all that, because if you multiply the number of homes times the amount saved every year, all that is money that would be going off to utilities in Saudi Arabia and places like that. And instead it can stay here on Long Island. And we estimate that by the time you get to the 20-year range, it's actually going to be approaching $50 million a year that'll stay here on Long Island. And that's assuming a relatively low growth
mm-hmm.
in fuel costs.
Right.
20 years from now,
rather
fuel could be a lot more
expensive. Rather than investing in fossil fuels, which obviously we don't have on Long Island. So, and that's a whole nother subject. I mean, we are creating and we're trying to expand this, really an industry in green jobs.
That's right, this green collar industry.
Yes, yes.
Now, if you recall from your hearing in 2006 when we proposed this law, the industry came forward and made a kind of reasonable point, which is at first they kind of opposed it, but
mm-hmm.
then the builders said, look,
yes.
we'll support it provided there's enough people to do the work.
Trained, yes.
And so we said we need some time to train.
Right,
and that's exciting to see that over that time period, a lot of people did get trained. And those are essentially all new sort of sector of workers now. So we have people who
Hers
are trained,
Hers mm-hmm.
raters, which is great because now they know how to make a home efficient.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, we think, you know, obviously there's always a next step.
Oh,
so a big part of the next step is when you have an existing home, because that law only applies to new homes, we want to make the existing homes more
Absolutely.
Efficient. I know there are thousands of contractors on Long Island doing renovations,
mm-hmm.
putting on extra rooms, you know,
mm-hmm.
changing windows, doing all sorts of projects, and we'd really like to see them start to get trained in energy efficiency so that when someone says, well, you know, I have these dimmable light bulbs and I can't seem mm-hmm. to switch them to energy efficient. Well, you know, it can be switched. It's just a little bit extra work rather than just changing the
mm-hmm.
bulb. You have to do some
mm-hmm.
work inside
mm-hmm.
the walls. But you can make that room much more energy efficient
yes.
and the contractors should know this
mm-hmm.
stuff. And right now they really don't.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the next big areas. And
yes.
of course that involves light, but it does have programs to provide incentive
mm-hmm.
and, you know,
we use their REAP program.
Okay.
I think it was residential energy.
I think the A is affordability. And which is geared towards, so that's income-based.
Yes, it's right? income-based,
yeah. Which is, it's a good program. You know, of course, one of the, you know, the Long Island Index did a study, you know, we've often relied on their studies on Long Island, and one of their studies showed, which is kind of common sense, I guess, but it showed that, first of all, it showed about 70% of homeowners have switched light bulbs on Long Island. So the message is getting out,
at least
the light bulb idea, people realize.
Which saves a lot of energy.
You can do a lot just with the light bulb, so that's it's a crazy thing not to
mm-hmm,
do.
Mm-hmm.
But then they also showed that the more money you had, the higher income bracket you were in, the more likely you've taken these measures. And that's
more likely you have?
You have.
Really?
And so it's not that you needed it as much financially.
Mm-hmm.
But that you had the ability to incur the upfront costs.
Okay.
So
mm-hmm.
there are upfront costs with
yes.
most efficiency things. If you go for an efficient refrigerator versus
mm-hmm.
a less efficient refrigerator, you're going to probably
mm-hmm.
pay a couple $100 more.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do the same thing down the line. You talk about windows,
okay.
you talk about air conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Each one is a little bit extra upfront cost. But of course, what we were always trying to convince people is you're going to save it back each year for years afterwards.
Some
but still,
can't
if your finances are very tight,
right.
and let's say the refrigerator died on you,
mm-hmm.
you've got to replace it, and
mm-hmm.
you're going to the store and you're looking, and
mm-hmm.
the difference of a couple $100 could, you know, you may say, well, you know, penny wise, dollar foolish, whatever it might be, but that's what you're stuck with. And so We need programs to help people make that decision.
And we are looking to adopt programs like that within the town, some innovative programs that have been adopted elsewhere. So we certainly want to work with you and Neighborhood Network to develop something like that for the town.
I think so we've laid a good foundation with the new homes.
Yes.
Now we have to talk about ways to renovate
take the next step.
More of the existing homes.
Yes.
So that's, you know, that's a big area.
Right. And how about renewables? I mean, you often hear about solar and wind.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're up to something like 1,300 homes on Long Island, 1,300 homes that have solar panels. It's a very good thing. The negative is that it's still expensive.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of talk. They've come down more than 40% in the last 7 years in cost. And there's a lot of talk of some potential breakthroughs, solar panels that are embedded into materials that you don't need the more expensive.
I
always
have
to explain to people with solar is that it's the right thing to do from the environment. It's still a somewhat expensive investment.
Yes.
LIPA has a great program where they cover about half the cost, and then there's some money you get from federal taxes and state taxes. But after all said and done, it is still a significant.
It's a long-term payback period.
You're probably looking
solar.
At it in the 10-year plus range. It could even be 11 or 12 year.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, every year as energy costs go up, that
time period
can get shorter. But we still need a breakthrough in the cost. On the other end of the scale, of course, is the efficiencies that we talked about. That's the cheapest thing, change of light bulbs, stuff like that. With the renewables, it's a little bit more of making a long-term commitment.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, this town has gone the route of installing a wind turbine.
Mm-hmm.
We did some research to see what's available in terms of small wind turbines that a homeowner or a farmer, you know, you kind of need a fair amount of land to do the turbine. I mean, is it going to be a basic rule that whatever its height is, it has to be clear of not falling into a roadway or
need
a relatively large lot. Plus, it has to be kind of above the trees.
Yes.
So there's going to be some height issues. And some of the towns have looked at code changes that said if you have 1 or 2 acres, usually that's around the cutoff point, then they'll say you can put up a turbine and get that height exception.
Mm-hmm.
But some homeowners have kind of jumped at buying some of these turbines because you can find them on the internet and such, but you need to realize if you have a fair amount of trees or a house nearby, the wind will be blocked by those things, and that will make it much less efficient, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
You know, here at Town Hall, it seems to usually be
right
spinning away.
Right on top of Bald Hill, yes.
It's got the pretty good clearance here. Right. But so there are some locations that we should be looking at and continue to do that. But in the near term, solar is the most viable. There's also geothermal, which for reasons that are still a little confusing to me, haven't caught on Long Island.
It's confusing to me too, because I think that would be almost a no-brainer. I have gone into several homes that have been given tours in them that have geothermal. On geothermal, can you just explain how
it
works?
There's a couple different types that I can make them confusing, but the most common one is basically tubes are placed into the ground, so you need to dig a hole in the ground.
Okay.
So it works in a new construction where the house is being installed in the first place or a large building, because there's already lots of heavy equipment on the site. So then they dig down only, you know, about a half dozen feet, and they get to a point where the ground is going to stay consistently in the mid-50s temperature-wise. And so you run this tubing through that in such a way so that if it's 95 degrees out and you want the inside to be air-conditioned, well, you have this water that's running through these tubes that's approximately 55 degrees, and you run that into the air conditioner. It's much easier to generate cooling for your house.
Sure.
And the same thing during the winter, if it's 32 degrees out, you have this constant temperature
of 50 degrees.
Right, basically making your whole system more efficient.
Backup system would be?
Well, it could be either types.
Okay.
So, you know, you're going to have
a backup heating.
You might have electric,
system.
you might have basically each of the choices. So
many
people say, well, I'm paying for both systems. So there's a amount of thrill about them. And it particularly makes sense when you're building a new home, because that upfront cost can be worked right into the mortgage. It just hasn't caught on. People haven't heard about it as much. But geothermal is a viable alternative. It is being used at, I saw a list of about 50 facilities on Long Island. So it's not as if no one's doing it. It's just that it hasn't caught on in a big way. Solar, as we mentioned, that's very straightforward. There is a good program. The thing I didn't mention was you do need to check your home and see that you have some southern exposure and that it's not shaded. Even the relatively small amount of area that's blocked off from shade will
affect it. That's the issue I'm having with my husband. He wants to cut down some trees. I prefer not to do that.
So
we're having that discussion. That's a big issue.
I love coffee. I love tea. I love the Jaffa Jive, and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Java.